Let's do the pledge of allegiance, start with the music on the back, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Welcome everyone here. We are videoing this tonight and it will be on YouTube. So if you want to see it on YouTube later on, you're welcome to take a look at it. This is a work session. There'll be no decisions or anything of that nature made tonight. We're willing to hear from people. We don't have a podium to go up to, but Jason can move the camera over to you. Please, this needs to be calm and civil. Your comments this evening, please, we need to have a calm and civil discussion on what you would like to discuss. At this point, I would like to go ahead and open it up. If somebody would like to speak, if they'd like to support, you want to say something? City manager would like to say something to start with. Go ahead.
Thank you all for being here. I think it's very cool for transparency for us to come together and try to finally get this resolved. With that being said, I will remain neutral and not answer any questions pertaining to the investigation or the future of the department. I am now looking at things from a different angle and some new information. So with that being said, I will again remain neutral across all avenues. But I do really appreciate everybody coming here. And this is how communities get to be resolved by these open forums. So again, thanks a lot.
Okay. Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
This is the third meeting that we as council have addressed this particular subject. In addition to our spending $10,000 of public money to address this particular subject, I'm glad that we have a good turnout. I'm glad people are going to give us their thoughts. I certainly hope we get new thoughts tonight rather than the third or the fourth time going over the same information. If there's new additional information, I for one am most anxious to hear it. If it's a rehash, let's save time and not go back.
Yeah, I would like to ask, in Brad Phillips' absence, I understand he's in Jamaica on vacation, if there's someone here from the Quiet Corps, if there's any questions from here to be asked, that can ask those, can answer those questions. If there's someone in his place.
Your acting chief's there.
I'm sorry?
Your acting chief is there.
I don't know everybody in my face, Rick. That's why I'm asking. Who can do that?
I was assigned as the acting chief under the direction of Ward Bowler, assistant chief, and Randy Bridge. I will try to answer any questions.
Okay, and that's what I want to know. There was questions from here. Who has you? Who appointed you?
Only because Brad's on vacation.
Okay, and you are the assistant chief, I'm under?
No, I'm a captain.
It was not, I had no say so in that, so don't put me in
there. What you just said, under your direction.
It wasn't under my direction. I had no clue until it came out in writing.
Okay, I'll save that question for later. But okay, you will be asking, why would you be answering the questions when we have an assistant chief?
And that's a good point, because as Ward said, he found out that I was under his direction at the same time I did when I got the email. So.
There is a change of pace in the fire department.
Yes,
there is.
I know there is, because I've got it right here looking at it.
Okay. It's not followed. Okay.
Okay, that's good. Okay, that's fine. Okay. That's fine.
Just keep going around.
Yeah, that's when we will answer.
All right, please, when you get up to speak, if you can try and keep it as close to 5 minutes as you can, or less, that would be warranted, please. Mr. McIntyre, yes.
Yeah, thank you, sir. One of the things I wanted to add, and I'm not a great wordsmith, so sit with me here, and I don't mean to offend anyone. That's the last thing I want to do, and I want to thank all the fire department and first responders for all the service you do. There's two issues I want to bring up, and one's with some of the issues with the fire department. The other one is just talking about the investigation. I know Mr. Bridge isn't going to go too much into it based on your comments earlier, but the first thing I have, and this is what I want to find out tonight. There are two things, and I want to find out these two things. First of all, there was a letter that came out. We know about that. There's rumors floating around. I don't know if they're substantiated or not. But then we spent the city money, taxpayer money, to do an investigation. And My understanding is that not a lot of the people who have a problem with the fire chief came forward and participated in the investigation. That may or may not be true, I don't know. But the rationale given behind that was people were afraid of retribution. Then 2 weeks later, after we got the results from the investigation, suddenly we have a lot of people here from the fire department saying the investigation was flawed, there's still tons of issues, and I guess in 2 weeks, no one's no longer afraid of any retribution. So I don't understand how, in the first half, someone can be afraid of issues that may arise, and then 2 weeks later, they're not. So what I want to know from the detractors is, are there really issues with the fire department, how it's being run, the management, problems like what came out in the letter, or are a lot of issues politically driven because they want a new chief and a group of people are not happy with the chief and we're doing a political maneuvering to try to make that happen? That's the first thing I want to know. I want proof of what's really going on. Is it politically driven or are these serious issues? The other issue I have with the investigation, there again have been rumors that the investigation was not really an investigation, it was something else, it didn't fully go into detail, so I'm hoping tonight, I know Mr. Bridges is going to discuss it, but maybe some members of council can let me know if they have a better understanding of it than I do, whether this investigation was thorough, and whether all the issues that came up from the rumor mill, from the letters, were significantly addressed and rectified, in which case the findings that everything is basically in tip-top shape, those findings will be solved. So those are the two things I want to find out. What's really happening, and if the investigation is the investigation. And that's what I'm looking for tonight with this meeting. Thank you, Chair.
Anyone else on council has something to say before we ask people in the audience? Anyone else? Okay. Please hold up your hand and stand up. Come up front if you would. Let's go back to the back first, Rick. Could you come up front so we can hear you? Please, fans running, it makes it hard to hear.
We want to hear.
Need your name and address. If you're on the fire department, tell us what it is.
All right. My name is Rick Ritter. I'm on the fire department. I've been on the fire department for 42 years. I'm assistant chief of operations. And right now I'm on sick leave. So I'm not in operations right now. Don't count this toward my 5 minutes. Before I should say anything else, I want to thank everybody that was on council, everybody from the city building, everybody from the fire department, basically the whole city for all their kind words and prayers during my ordeal. And I really appreciate that, regardless of anything else. I well worn. It was Cheryl and I that was overwhelmed by it. So I do appreciate that. I won't go in order here. I'll start with number 7. I got interviewed by a phone interview for the investigators because I wasn't able to go to the firehouse. After a short conversation, which was just like the one we just had here, how you doing, chief? Sorry to hear about, he's a chief, I'm a chief, we had to just chatter. Next words out of his mouth, everybody wants to hoopall me or not, was, chief, we're not here to get anybody fired or any charges against anybody. We're here to take comments from the fire department so that we can make recommendations to improve the fire department. That's quote unquote, whether anybody likes it or not. So, I don't know where he said that to keep me from being worried about they was investigating me. I wasn't worried about whether they was investigating me or not. Okay? The second thing is, again, I'll go out of order so I can answer another one of your questions, is why is there not very many people coming to you? Why is it? I use your guys' words because I watched YouTube. I'm not going to get into a discussion about it. Your guys' words, not mine. Why is it only the old people in the fire department that's not happy about us being grounded? Okay? It's because the old people in the fire department are secure in their positions. I have, and I say I have guys and women working for me that have come and complained about things. But they've also, in the same breath, one of them, no names mentioned, one of them, chief, I'm not going to get up and jeopardize my hours. If my hours get cut significantly, I have to take my two kids out of Catholic school. Another one told me, if my hours get cut, I'm not going to be able to make car payments. This is not the old fire department where we're making $25 to $50 a week. These guys are making $15 an hour, basically. So, you know, for a 24-hour shift, that's a $300 bill. So, yeah, they're not going to, you know, they're going to bite the bullet. Come to work unhappy, come to work happy, and still brings in a paycheck. Okay? Grant structure. Fire department, all fire departments, all police departments have a rank structure. It can't operate without the rank structure being followed. I don't want to dwell on this, but like I said, I watched the YouTube. When I'm standing here, or when any of these officers that are in here standing here, the badge is standing here. It's not the person. If you don't like me, I don't care. But when you're talking to me, respect the position, respect the badge. And it, from one YouTube, it was Chief Moeller, it wasn't. And if that had been Sheriff Kelly's chief deputy addressing you guys for a problem and was addressed like he was, basically almost yelled at, you'd have got a call the next day, I guarantee you, from Chief Kelly, because it just isn't done. You know, if you don't agree, tell me. I don't agree with you. That's the story of my life in fire services. I don't agree with you. Well, if you don't agree with me, put your butt in there anyhow. We need to put this fire out, okay? And the rank structure, I'll address this too. I know I'm addressing some hot potatoes, I'm not making anybody. I appreciate it. Jen said she didn't know anything about being put in the position she was put in. But that's a slap in the face to every fire department in Ohio, that a captain gets brought around an assistant chief for a week. Okay? It just doesn't happen. I have been acting chief three times, or interim chief three times, and acting chief probably 25 or 30 times. When a chief goes away, it might be for a weekend. Letter goes out and says, I'll be gone for the weekend. Chief Ritter has the helm. If you have any problems, call me. It's just the way it is. If Huber's chief goes away, I don't know what the next down is. I don't know if they have a deputy chief or not. But assistant chief, deputy chief, whoever in that rank structure takes over. And the third thing, the last thing I want to bring up, my 5 minutes is pushing out, is communications in the firehouse, as far as I'm concerned, are non-existent. For 2.5 years, the number of staff meetings that the chief and the two assistant chiefs have had by themselves, which is the discussion what's going on in the fire department, in 2.5 years has been zero. Never have I had a staff meeting. The previous chiefs went from once a week, which to once a month, okay? But at least it was communication. I, just like Chief Bowman just said, I learn about things the same way that, I learn about things the same time he learns about it, by an email that's put out. It's not how you run a radar. Okay, yes, sir.
Can I ask for clarification?
I hope.
Did you say that in 2.5 years?
Well, I don't know. From the time that Chief Phillips has been chief.
That's fine. That's
the time that Tracy left.
Right. That's not your point. The important part is, and I'm not sure I understood you correctly. In that time, you have never had a meeting with Brad Phillips or none of us.
Oh, no. No, we've had officers' meetings.
Okay, officers.
All, I don't know.
how many officers we got, board?
Seven, eight.
Where all eight officers are in the room, and you go around the room.
Okay.
But, you know,
that's no staff meetings.
Well, it was officers meetings. They was more informational meetings, a PowerPoint, and it was, here's what we're doing, here's what we're going to buy, here's what we bought, here's, you know, just not so much what do you think, but informational meetings.
Okay.
And if need be, which should be, if need be, maybe a little butt ripping, or, you know, if you look bad on this run, or you look bad on this, that's fine. Or just the opposite. Maybe you look good in this. Okay?
So,
all right.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
One question here, Chief.
Do what?
Did this staff meeting not happen? Was
oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
You're fine. The staff meetings. Did Chief Young have staff meetings?
Who?
Chief Young.
Chief Young had staff meetings.
He did?
Yes.
Okay.
Even going clear back to...
Do you remember about the frequency that Chief Young had with staff meetings?
Yeah, I'd say once every 2 weeks. Once every couple of weeks. And the staff meeting might only... it might only last 10 minutes, you know? It might... You couldn't get your cup of coffee finished before the staff meeting was over with.
Sure.
And sometimes it was somebody needed to go in and make another pot of coffee. So,
and you did the time frame you gave when that was 2.5 years. That you
he
had.
Was mistaken. A year and a half.
I don't know how long he's been here. I've had so many chiefs, they're hard to keep track of.
So we're taking up a lot of time. I understand.
Thank you.
Going on the same things. You have a question?
I do have a question. One thing you said really caught my attention was about the rank structure not being adhered to. Is it common for people of a lower rank to be put in positions of authority over a senior?
No.
Is this
no.
Okay.
That's the first time I've ever seen it. I was a full-time firefighter. I guarantee you, if the chief right pack goes on vacation and puts a captain in charge of that base, he's probably lost a $150,000 job by the time he's back. Okay.
I think the equivalent of Mr. Bridgman on vacation, and he put the person who takes care of Kathy Marshall in charge.
Yeah, Kathy, you've got the helm on.
Thank you, Chief. We appreciate it. Who would like to go next? Your name and also.
My name is Daniel Rim. I'm a 12-year veteran of the New Carolina Fire Department. I hope all of you received the handout that I passed out earlier prior to. I am going to bounce around a little bit. I'm trying to touch off of what Chief Ritter said. In the packet, you'll find, Exhibit 2 and Exhibit 3. Exhibit 2 is the organizational chart, and also an email sent out by Chief Phillips on August 18th. As such, it says, basically gives the organizational breakdown, which is on the very last page. So it shows the rank structure, shows Chief Phillips down to Assistant Chief Ward Moeller, and then due to resignations, illnesses, injuries, there was some jumbling around with the rank structure. But on that very last page, you can see what the rank structure looks like. It shows the three captains are below Assistant Chief Moeller. And Assistant Chief Moeller, as far as I know, you're not on any leave or anything. No. So, in that email, at the very last paragraph, it states, I cannot stress enough that the chain of command must be followed on all issues. Recent events are a glaring example of how I have not reinforced the chain of command resolution and control. This is a paramilitary organization run as such. You go to Exhibit 3, which is put out 2 days later, from also Chief Phillips. I'm sorry, 2 days later, on August 20th. I will be out of the area on vacation starting 8:21 and return 8:28. Captain Jennifer Bowman will have the helm while I'm gone, with administrative support from City Manager Bridge and Assistant Chief Moeller. Captain Bowman will be acting fire chief until I return. Now, as I learned tonight, I did not know that Captain Bowman had any idea that this was coming down, but I've watched council meetings, we've stressed, and I believe wholeheartedly that we need to follow the chain of command. In my own personal opinion, I believe that the chain of command was broken. Assistant Chief Mobile was skipped.
Can I ask one question? I'll interrupt you. Mr. Moeller, do you have all the certifications you need or all the testing done that you need to have done to run this fire department while Ms. Chief Phillips is
away? I have all the certifications I need to run the fire department, yes.
Do you have your protocol testing done?
I don't have a protocol test done. I don't need a protocol test to run the fire department.
So the protocol test deal with EMS services?
It does. It only the function has. I don't schedule EMS. Sure.
Okay.
So I have, absolutely, I can run the fire department.
Without the protocol test?
Without the protocol test, absolutely.
Sure.
Mr. Round, you said 14 years you've been on?
12 years.
Well, since what's your rank?
I am just firefighter paramedic. Secondly, the very first page you'll see, it's actually labeled Fairborn Fire Department Promotional, Lieutenant Promotional Process. The reason I bring this forward is currently, when we had some previous officers promoted, I seriously considered putting in for the process and putting in for promotion. The reason I did not do it is because the writing was already on the wall as to who was going to get promoted. I knew for a fact it would just basically be a waste of my time to put my name into that hat to get promoted. Unfortunately, it's been an ongoing issue, and you see this happen in numerous departments across the nation. My suggestion would be go to a completely blind process where, and that's kind of what's outlined in this exhibit. It's a process to promote, and it takes away any chances of nepotism, any chances of favoritism, and basically brings forward a basically you are no longer a name while you're going through the process, you're a number. And that number is what's carried along with you. If you'd like, I don't want to cut into my, I can explain this entire process. This is, like I said, this is just a possibility to bring forward for, you know, to bring forward for a promotion. It would have to be tweaked to fit New Carlisle's specifications. Things would need to be removed, things would need to be added, but it's basically a guideline that we could possibly use to enhance or ensure that the there's little nepotism and favoritism that goes along with it. Basically, it's a three-step process. It's a written test. It's an assessment center with outside evaluators, and it's an interview process. And like I said, if you'd like either later or if you'd like me to expand now on it, I'd certainly be happy to do so.
You have a copy of this?
Yes, certainly.
Thank you.
Do we have a question from
yes.
The city manager?
You said this was from Fairborn Fire Department?
Yes, I am also a career firefighter for the city of Fairborn.
Okay, do you know any other fire departments that use this protocol?
There's quite a few that I do know. I do know from the city of Huber Heights does do a very similar process. Enon, when Chief Tracy Young went there, actually we had used a similar process to this when Chief Tracy Young was here.
Okay.
I actually sat in as one of the evaluators for that process. I know that they do it at Enon now. I know Bethel Park has done the exact same. And I know Assistant Chief Bottoman from Bethel Park, I know she'd probably say the exact same. So there are numerous departments who use a format similar to this for their internal promotions.
Did they get this information from the state board or anything to draft their own?
That I'm not sure.
Okay.
But like I said, I bring this forward just as a possible solution to what I perceive as a problem, to what I know other members of the department perceive as a problem.
You just said that when Tracy Young was here, he used a similar thing.
Correct.
But when Tracy left, just kind of went to the filing cabinet and then...
Correct. We had a couple promotions where we had one promotion where it was for the position of captain that I considered putting in for. The deadline to put in for it came, and 2 hours later, the person was appointed to that position.
And you had
put in for as well?
I was going to, but I, like I said, I did not put in for it. I knew the writing was on the wall.
Okay.
Yes, and I can't exactly remember how many people put in for that, but I know it was more than just one.
Okay.
Third, open, the final thing I have is open shifts and vacancies. We currently have 42 members on the department. I went through the roster, and you'll find the roster with Exhibit 4. Next to each member is their, if it's a P, that means they're a paramedic. If it's a B, it means they're a basic. If it's an A, they're advanced. T's training. But basically goes through, if there's nothing next to it, basically they're just a, they're a firefighter. We currently have 7 fire-only personnel. We have 16 EMT basic or advanced personnel, and we have 19 paramedics. Of those 19 paramedics, I know for a fact 10 work full-time at other outlying departments. The reason I bring this up is we recently had a schedule published for the next 28 days. I went through right before that schedule was published of people that put in for those shifts. Of the 27 days that were available in that scheduled period, of the 28 days, 27 of the days had open vacancies, which means that there were shifts that were not filled. After the schedule was published, you will find the schedule that you have in front of you in Exhibit 5. Some of the shifts that you see on here are for special assignments, such as the football games, for EMS coverage at the football games. However, if you go through specifically, if you look at the 30th, Sunday, August 30th, you have three separate shifts that are left unassigned that are currently vacant. Now, if in the meantime between the 22nd when I printed this off, there is a possibility that somebody could have picked those shifts up. But once again, if you go over to the fourth page, Saturday, September 5th, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different positions that are available that are open still on the trade board. That means currently there is nobody scheduled to work those days. Currently there is no coverage of either Elizabeth Township or in the city of New Carlisle currently for those days. Now that's not to say that, you know, down the line, in the next day or so, that people pick those shifts up. But unfortunately, with the amount of staffing that we have, it's getting to the point where people are working more hours and more hours. And like former Chief Grout said at previous council meetings, there are people that are working in excess of 36, 42, 48 hours a week. And that's on a week-by-week-by-week basis.
Question I would have on that. Why are there not other people stepping forward and taking these assignments?
Other people have, you know, myself, I'm a full-time firefighter paramedic for the city of Fairborn, so I work every third day. 10 of the firefighter paramedics of those 19 that I mentioned also are full-time firefighter paramedics at other full-time departments. The remaining 9, many of them have other jobs at other departments that they also have requirements. Many of us have children. Many of us have families that we're trying to tend to.
So you said there are 42.
Currently, there are 42
people.
Personnel
in the fire department.
Correct.
And we cannot get these staffed because of the issues that you just said.
Correct. We, as
so
far
we
as I know,
people, is that what you said?
As far as I know, we have not had a, other than firefighter Jerry Medoff that I know of, we have not brought any firefighter paramedics on recently.
It's not a
paramedic. I'm sorry. Yeah. And actually, Jerry Medoff is a intermediate, I believe, or a base intermediate.
All right, are you finished, sir?
We have a question. Yes, I did. Thank you, sir. You said the positions haven't been filled, no people have come in. Is that because there is a lack of availability of these people, or because no one is going out looking for these people, putting out applications, trying to get them in the fire department? The blame has to lie somewhere.
Right.
And I don't know about an individual person.
Some of the issues, I do realize that the summer people are a lot more busy during the summer, so typically, even at my full-time job, it's harder to take time off during the summer. However, this has been an ongoing problem. It's gotten to the point where, you know, we have more and more shifts available on a month-by-month-by-month basis. Part of the issue that I feel is, I did some research today, and I called around to a bunch of different departments in the area, and this is something that's going to have to be addressed by council, and I know money situations are tight, but if I'm a brand new paramedic coming in, and I have 5 applications sitting in front of me, and I have, I've applied at 5 different places, and I can only accept maybe 2 or 3 of those positions. Right now, as a firefighter paramedic, I make $12.69 an hour working for the city of New Carlisle. You go down the list, Springfield Township, this is according to their, one of their EMS chiefs, Chris Heaton, they make $16 an hour. Enid, according to Captain J.R. Rowell, $13.50 an hour. This is just strictly paramedics. Bethel Clark, $14.75 an hour. Bethel Miami, $13 an hour. And Moorfield Township, according to their assistant chief, $19 an hour. So we are at the lower end of where every, so if I have 5 applications sitting in front of me, and I have to choose what's best for myself and my family, I'm probably going to go to other places. I believe that's probably, my own personal opinion, I believe that's possibly one of the reasons why we're having difficulty getting people in the door, getting people hired, and getting people to stay.
Thank you. Okay.
So the staffing issue isn't per se, it's not an individual's fault. It sounds like what you're saying is, I mean, this has been a problem for many years now, and it's just getting worse and worse.
It's been getting
so
worse.
So the fire department and the city of New Carlisle have just kind of not been staying up with the times. I just want to make sure I understood.
Thank you.
So you said that a little bit of township is, according to this chart, is uncovered.
I believe those shifts normally have the weight, and Captain Bowen could fill me in a little bit better. Typically, those medic shifts are covered first because contractually they're required to have an EMT or a paramedic out there, and then the EMT basic, and then is that kind of how the schedule goes?
I base the schedule on when I put the schedule out. We don't have enough people on staff to cover the entire schedule. And then the second aspect of it is people put in their availability, and I have to base the schedule based on Dan's availability, Steve's availability, whoever's availability. So when I get ready to publish the schedule, there is tons of open shifts. Now anybody can pick up those shifts if they're qualified to pick up those shifts. Dan can pick up any medic shift, any EMT spot that he would like. My problem is nobody wants to work weekends. I beg work on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I send out probably 3 messages today saying, hey, we need coverage on these days. Who wants to step up and do this? And yes, people are getting a lot of hours, as, and I have never met Mr. Grout, so I don't know him. There are a lot of hours, and a lot of people are getting a lot of hours. I can honestly tell you that 14 years ago, my husband and I decided after the loss of a child that I was not going to work full-time. I was going to work part-time. This job, I am here constantly. This has become a full-time job for me, and I'm not getting the benefits of it, I'm not getting any overtime, and I'm away from my family. This is not something that I want. So the people in the letter, whoever wrote the letter that said I'm trying to make this a full-time job, they're wrong. Totally wrong. Because I made that decision back in 2001. Not to have a full-time job, so I could be with my children. And now I'm away from them. I'm away from them today. I'll probably have to work these shifts this weekend because there's nobody picking these shifts up. So I want to be away from my daughter's volleyball game. I want to be away from my son's band competition because I feel dedicated to the citizens here and to New Carlisle Fire Division that I don't want us to lose the contract with Elizabeth Township because people do like to work.
Feel like that's in jeopardy?
I do not. Because we always,
have every shift covered out there? Because they're
we've never not had a shift covered out there. Since I've been doing the schedule for a year and a half now.
bring this one without having something prepared.
Okay.
Next
time.
I can give you the entire history. Yes.
Thank you very much. And then two, what it sounds like to me is we have 42 people on the shift, and you said it's not enough to cover, but then how you do the scheduling is you base off people's availability. So it sounds like to me is we need to align people that have our availability what we need. You know, if you guys are out there and there's all these open shifts left, you don't want to work because it's a Saturday. I mean, Lord, I don't want to work on Saturdays. I don't want to work on Sundays.
And we have looked at very many different options to get things covered. One of the problems is this is a part-time department. So we do fall under so many laws. Like, if I schedule people for a 48-hour week, then you're going to have to offer them benefits, whether it's insurance, you know, whether it's, you know, whatever. I have people on the schedule that are certified to work and have come to me and say, hey, I only want 12 hours every other week. So I can't fill a schedule with 12 hours every other week. I have people that have come to me and say, well, I only want 12 hours on such and such a day. So I put them in there. So yes, there's tons of open shifts, but I constantly, and every one of them can tell you that I'm constantly sending out a message saying, hey, cover this, cover this, cover this, cover this. And then I'm going home and I'm having to tell my kids, I can't find coverage, so I'm going to have to go in and cover that shift so that way nothing's jeopardized.
Are we safe to assume that this would be an issue even if Brad Phillips wasn't our view?
It was an issue when Tracy was here. I worked under Tracy, and I don't know how many messages he sent out asking people, and it was one of those that I picked up tons of shifts there, you know, when I was a firefighter medic. And it was one of those that when the shifts are available, anybody can pick them up. And I rotate the schedule around to make sure that Elizabeth Township is covered by ALS. That's what the contract says.
I will say in that same vein, she has done sent out tons of emails asking for coverage. We haven't hired any paramedics, so we're down. When Chief Grout was the fire chief, we had twice as many paramedics as what we do now.
I can address that also.
Do you think our low pay is?
I think it's probably two and threefold.
Sure.
That's a big part of it. I can tell you right now, and it's public record, and you guys already looked it up. I make $14.21 an hour. I can tell you when I left the part-time ambulance service that I worked for, I was making $17.50 an hour when I left there, and that was 6 years ago.
Can you supply me with the hour list?
Yeah, I can make a copy.
Like I said,
it's just a handwritten copy, but.
We have hired two paramedics in the last month. One has not scheduled to do his orientation. One is going through orientation, and he just stopped. So I tried making contact with him today to find out if he intends to finish his orientation and then become a scheduled employee, but I haven't heard back from him yet.
Okay, Mr. Craig Walker has a question.
Yes, sir.
For either of you, when you hire somebody, do you tell them you have to work a certain amount of hours?
No.
That's what it really is.
And when I do the schedule, I schedule the people that are scheduled. I try to keep it at 24 to 30 hours a week. So that way when we're falling into the 1500 hour rule, which I think is Senate Bill 160,
but that's still a problem. Right,
so right, and it's still in Congress. That's a part-time rule that's like 1,500 hours a year or something like that. And with the Obamacare Act, Health Care Act coming down, there's different rules and everything. Ohio has thrown out the Health Care Act. It's still at the federal level. So that's going to be part of it also.
You work full-time someplace else.
Correct. I work full-time at the city of Perry.
How many hours?
I work
like 2 days.
It's on a 24, 48-hour shift. So basically every third day I work 24 hours. I go in at 8 a.m. and then I get off at 8 a.m. the following day. And of the 19 paramedics, 10 of them work that similar shift.
Yeah. I think that's one of the big problems, though. Wouldn't that be a big problem? You know, if you're working 48 hours one place, you know,
correct,
then you're not available. Actually, you want to spend at least 24 hours and say hello to your wife.
And I will say that I try and schedule myself. You know, I put in an availability where I'm available anywhere from 30 to 30 to 42 hours a week.
Okay, my next question is, and I'm just assuming this from what you're, what both of you have said, because this word keeps coming up, more money. Okay, keeps coming up. So if you got more money, you're more available?
Not necessarily. But I will tell you,
you'd be able to increase the staff hourly.
Yeah, and I think, and if there was, if the hourly rate was higher, this is just my own personal, I think we'd have more people interested in coming in. I understand the turmoil might be scaring some people away right now until, you know, maybe people might be laying low until the dust proverbial dust settles. But an increase in pay would definitely help. And like I said, that's something that council would have to address.
It makes you feel any better, all schools, any new for a lot of employees are severely underpaid for the national.
Yes,
sir. Go ahead.
You seem like a very good person, so I would like to ask you a question. It's just been said by more than one person that it's felt that some people are not coming in and doing runs or whatever, maybe because of the wage, correct? Okay. My question to you is it possible they're not coming in because of the turmoil?
Possibly.
Thank you.
Or possibly. I'm about to ask a question that we're going to have.
You get the skate on this one. Captain?
Yes, sir.
At the end of Tracy's career with the front office, how many people want him in the department?
That, I would have to look that up. I don't know.
Good guess?
Probably between 50 and 60, I would say.
Mr. Grout?
About the same. Closer to 60. And we tried to focus on more paramedics, not because we didn't want EMTs, but in case we did have call-offs, we had more paramedics on duty, so we could fall back.
Okay, I've allowed you 15 minutes with the two of you going, so if you would please, let's give somebody else a chance. Yes, we can go.
We got a little bit of a PowerPoint presentation. I got into this because my thought wanted to know problem. And I think as most of you council members know that prior to the investigation, I had offered a four-member panel to do that investigation for no charge to the city. I'm not knocking the investigation. I think those fellows did a good job on what they did. However, I think if you're finding out now that we have quite a few problems. Number one, money. Number two, staff. Number three, filling of the schedule. Go ahead, Ron. I think we need basically to explore the staffing opportunities with surrounding departments to possibly go to some other. We've got to increase the staffing to meet the future demand. Right now, looking at what I saw as a mutual aid breakdown. In 2014, we had 65 calls into the city for mutual aid. That was on the EMS call. That was money lost. We could have billed that amount of money and brought that in, which would have increased our staffing, which would have increased our revenue. In 2015, already we've had 45 calls for mutual aids inside the city. We've had 27 out. My only concern is if we have a staff of three on duty at the engine house, you pull that medic out. Captain Bowman, can you tell me approximately how long it takes for an EMS room? Just a ballpark.
What do you mean, EMS? From the time we're on scene,
from the time the alarm comes in, till they're back to the engine.
An hour?
To go pick up a patient, take them to spring break.
I can pull the numbers.
That's all right. Just give me a look.
I'm saying approximately an hour. We're back in service. It depends on, it all depends on the run.
And again, if we've got a I full arrest and you go to Monument Valley?
No, we're not going to make a full arrest in Monument Valley, but look at it.
Okay, well, I'm working with these kids. Would you say 2 hours on something in that case?
Yeah, so a full arrest is going to be anything that's traumatic. It's probably going to be around an hour and a half to 2 hours. I mean, it all depends on what you have to do and how busy the hospital is.
The reason I'm asking you is, if we've got an hour that the ambulance is out of town, it's another hour that we don't have coverage. Sure, you have mutual aid. Your mutual aid time frame is anywhere from 6 to 10 minutes from anyone in the neighboring department. That's just to get them into town. If it's another 4 to 5 minutes to get them on scene, now we're from 10 to 15 minutes. You have a heart attack, 10 to 15 minutes is not a good goal for an hour. You have a major structure fire, that crew is on the ambulance. Now you've got to call mutual aid. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you've lost a building. We definitely need a backup. We are letting our citizens down. No way, shape, or form. We're letting them down. Now, if we were a big enough city where we had two engine houses, two crews, fine. We could pull the other. We need to look at the possibility of either adding personnel into that station to where we're going to be able to respond to two runs. If you've got them out on a fire run, that second engine is very vital. We had a house fire in Edgeboro. As a matter of fact, it happens to be Ron's daughter's house. I happened to live 2 houses from there. That was not a pretty scene. The engine went all the way out Lake Avenue to come in the back way. It didn't grab a hydrant coming in. When the engine got there, pump operator had a heck of a time. Water. The hose was bound up in the bed. He did get water. You had one man inside without an air pack. Could have been a loss of life. Like if you were over there. You need a hair of an air pack. Anyhow, we need to focus on what's going on with the department. That recruitment committee, I don't know how many they've gotten so far. But I think they're going to have a big problem with the pay scale. And with the turmoil that's in the department, this both areas need to be addressed and addressed quickly. I think you've got on there explore the possibilities of recruiting other members, including the Hispanic. I think that's fine, that's another opportunity. However, if we have a language barrier, that becomes another problem. Possibilities of Tecumseh, starting an EMT program over there to the juniors and seniors. I think that's an excellent idea to bring people into the community. When I was on the department, and I spent 23 years on this department, a lot of the people that are on the department at that time, their sons, and I can probably name the Taters, the Stitzels, are now on other departments in this area. We need that kind of background to bring our younger people on board. Fire division does an excellent job. Be it a fireman, be it an EMS, be it a paramedic. It's an excellent job. It's good for financial stability for your
people. Bill, I don't know if you can answer this or even guys out there. It seems like, you know, when I was younger and you were talking about, there was a lot more about seniors that seemed like that were more involved with the fire project. Why is that tapered off? Is it,
I mean, sort of, you're saying seniors, you're speaking older people?
It was like usually the higher class, you know, maybe, you know, some
high school seniors.
Well,
not like
older. Yeah, not like older.
be honest with you, I think back then, and we still are a bedroom community, I think there were a lot of people, and it started out with a lot of people downtown, the shop owner. The siren went off. His junior people took the shop over, he got on the engine and went. And as it went from then on, more of the townspeople became involved. Now, however, you've got a lot of townspeople that are working two and sometimes three jobs. Both man and wife are working to make ends meet. We don't have the free time to spend and give. Even though back then, when I was on the department, all of our money came in back in the treasury to buy what we needed. Say it was in the pockets. You can't blame them. Why go out there and work 30, 40 hours a week? As Jan said, she worked 40, 50 hours for less money than what she made on the engine. Private work. We need to get our act together. Not only in that, as I understand it, we're defunct. We could end up with an increase in our insurance rate going from 5, going from a 4, up to a possibly a 6, because we don't have the pump capacity. That's what I'm hearing. So Councilman, we're going to be talking about a new engine. Now, whether or not we've got that money in that fund, I don't know. I think we need to look at where the money is. We've got new Medicare that you're going to have to have also.
How do they determine what pump capacity you need?
There's various things that go into it, but it's basically how much fire load you can have in an area, downtown area. So they said that they determine based upon area size how much pump capacity you need. That's not the only contributing factor, though.
Can I, before you go any further, this is not that we realize that question. This is why I'm asking this, when I look at this stuff later, I know this. If we haven't annexed any more territory into our town, we haven't built any new houses, we haven't had more structures that can go up, how can they require us to increase our pump capacity?
Oh, they didn't. It didn't require us to increase it. Back when our last ISO evaluation occurred is when I was actually chief.
Okay.
And at that time, Elizabeth Township and New Carlisle worked out an agreement to have that engine in New Carlisle. When we did the evaluation, we were able to convince ISO that that engine was there and would assist in event of a major fire. So therefore, it satisfied the needs of them, and they didn't say anything else.
There's more than you're taking people from not structured and increasing vehicles.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, so no change.
Sure. So we're technically, we're a little short. That's the way we were then. Anyhow, going on.
Before you go on, I'm sorry. I've heard Elizabeth Township a number of times tonight now. We have an engine, they have an engine, they do have pyramids, they have units out there. We have two full-time from our department to man that pyramid. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yeah. Two full-time. So if there was a major fire or whatever in the city of New Carlisle, would they not respond back into the city from Elizabeth Township and vice versa if that happened? That New Carlisle would respond out there. Is that not happening at this point? If they have,
I think this is where your mutual aid comes in, be it Elizabeth Township, be it Pike, or be it Bethel. If you're going to have a major fire or incident, a plane crash or whatever, you're going to call
everyone. Correct. But I'm just saying, is it not used all the time between the two at this point? Is what I'm asking.
True, but I think. Are you referencing pump capacity? Is that what you're looking at?
I'm looking at any type of service that may be needed that New Carlisle can't fulfill at that time. Would Elizabeth Township come to the city or come to that?
They were under mutual aid. We can't count Elizabeth Township's engine as ours anymore. As that company. Is that what you're talking about?
To answer your question, sir, yes.
No.
To answer the question.
To answer your question, no.
No, they would not.
Elizabeth Township has their own FDID at this time. ISO won't count them as our engine anymore. ISO counted those two people and that engine in the, in our pumping capacity at the time. They now have their own FDID. Chief Young changed them over. They have their own fire department ID number. They're separate. They will not count those personnel.
Okay, thank
you. There could be seven of them out there. We don't get a count.
Thank you. That's my question. Thank you. Appreciate it. Mr. Governor, sorry.
All right.
The operational and capital funds. Again, I think we need to look at that. I think we need to look at our future risks and probably figure out where we're going. So you, I guess you've asked for input. I'm giving it to you. You may not like what I got to say, guys. Here it is.
That's why we're here.
Size of New Carlisle, your talent pool is going to suffer.
5 miles, is it too small? Probably. Should we expand it out to 10? Maybe look at that, see what kind of option you can get when you do the heights? Possibly.
And I have to agree with what you're saying. However, again, with the way our department is structured now, and with only 3 people, you're limiting the availability of additional people to come in on a call or a major problem.
Sure.
This is what we're trying to point out.
This problem here goes back to what you guys were suggesting is the pay.
That's part of it. If you could flip back your screen, I'd like to address some of the things that were on the first page that we looked at. Or not.
Can I make a quick statement about the map just before we go back? I would just like to say that the individuals that live on the outside of that circle are not occupying space for someone else to come and work, if that makes any sense at all. There's not a cap, so like myself, I live in Springfield right now currently. I am currently looking to move back into the area. Like I addressed last meeting, I have to work with Bethel and people allow that do like the being able to respond on days that I am off, stuff like that. That's why I'm trying to move back in. But my spot that I hold is not prohibiting someone that lives inside of that circle from getting a position with the division.
Right. I think all we're
and that includes everyone on the outside of that circle. They're not holding anybody up from obtaining a position.
All we're trying to do is point out.
Right, I would just like to point that out so that there wasn't any assumptions or anything like that.
The question was asked for the magic word, the personnel leader. Go ahead.
Okay, in the in-house staffing, the number one, exploring staffing opportunities with surrounding departments. I've had numerous conversations with assistant chiefs, captains, and everything from other surrounding departments from here to find out what they are doing with their staffing and everything. Right now, Bethel, Miami is hiring. We have one of our firefighters that went for an interview this morning. The next thing, increase staffing to meet future demands. Research the SAFER grant. I can tell you I've written 2 SAFER grants. I have established 2 SAFER grants for other fire departments. We looked at doing a SAFER grant, and we're going to apply for it this year. The reason that we could not apply for it is because we didn't have a hiring process in place that showed that you were doing physicals, you were doing drug tests, you were doing background checks. So until that's put into place, we do not qualify for the SAFER grant. I used to write grants for a living. I've written $75 million worth of grants over my career. Okay, so if we go on to recruitment and retention, we said we can't look at, you know, we got a language barrier with the Hispanics. That's not true. Not true whatsoever. He just said that. That's not true. All classes are offered in more than one. No, if you have your time, let me speak.
Come on.
Okay. There are more than enough.
You need to take a breath because you're telling us. I understand you're trying to defend your department.
I am not trying to defend
your
department. This is what we don't want, okay? Please. Please let the person one at a time. We'll be happy to address it. One at a time speak. Mr. Cook had the floor. You asked him.
I did ask to speak.
So please
and
respond.
I'm sorry if you gave my tone the wrong way. I'm a very loud person. The next one, exploring the possibility of Tecumseh and allowing EMT training juniors and seniors. I spoke to Chief King just yesterday about this, that right now, in New Carlisle, we have an elementary school that has 3rd and 4th graders in it. The high school is in Bethel Clark's area. I spoke to Chief King about that yesterday, about could we piggyback onto it. If we have juniors and seniors that are in New Carlisle that live here, that are in the Explorer program or the Cadet program, could we piggyback onto that and use those kids? And he was all for it.
That, I think you're misunderstanding that one. That was go to the superintendent and see if they can actually have classes at the school as electives.
Okay.
That's what that was all
about. I'm all for that.
They do that
in
UCDC.
Okay. Could you go back to Mr. Cook, please? Mr. Cook, you have the floor, please. Sorry.
Anyhow, critical staffing levels, I think, are one of our greatest issues that need to be addressed. There's been a little several people about the fact of paying some of those agendas that were in the closed set. And I want to call it a pay on call, or where they are basically sitting at home, they get a reduced rate for staying there in order to be available if we do have a second run. Again, this is all going to have to be dependent upon money is available, that type of thing. And I think this has already been explained, there's been some scheduling problems, 27 out of 28 days, you've got us in shifts. I can understand Jennifer's working. I understand her dedication. This should not be. If she's working that many hours and she needs to be with her family, we have a problem. Case closed.
So who's not picking up the shifts?
I'm still that's where we're at. If we have not hired these people and said, you're going to work X amount of hours.
When you go look at the stats on this, we have 42 people, and we have still this many unopened shifts. Now you're saying if we have 50 people or 60 people, we're still going to have, that it's going to be a miracle we're not going to have any open shifts, or it's not going to be as heavy.
You're going to have some.
Or as open.
And why? Because you've got approximately 21 people working for other departments out of that 42.
Bill, or you guys, does the department have the leverage to say, okay, look, you guys aren't matching up with what we need?
It's a challenge when you're kind of the lowest in the area. It is a challenge, but I think the answer raises the question is what would make the difference is we're at 19 at paramedics right now. Essentially, we're double that, and that's why there wasn't the woods. There was still staffing challenges in all of the districts. It makes no difference whatsoever. But when you drop down to that level, it then becomes somebody's going to be married to that department, or you're not going to get shifts covered. And what Jen's saying is, I'm having to marry this department, and so is it three or four others. Until we increase that staff, it's going to be there.
I can give you a list of people who do not pick up.
Please hold on. Sorry.
Can you give me that?
Yeah.
Okay, monthly call buyer.
Okay, Mr. Cuthbert, would you go ahead, please?
things on Facebook that are, I will say, unbecoming a person in his position. And I won't go any further than that. Overspending. I would like to see council get involved to find out what has been bought and purchased within the last 2 years, or, I'm sorry, the last year and a half since Brad has been here. I understand there have been several things that have been purchased that were questioned. I'll leave it at that. Again, you've heard about no senior administrative meetings in the time period Brad's been here. We've got high numbers of hours that are working by the senior administration. Jennifer's already at that. We're back to the social media. I don't believe we need to get this department on social media. This definitely has got to stop. We don't need everything out there. I was on that department for 23 years. Everything was settled inside of the door. Sometimes it came almost to close. But the minute that door opened, it never went outside. Hostile work environment. I think somebody has already alluded to that fact that we do have a hostile work environment. If, whatever, I won't go in there. Morale. Morale has got to be low. It's got to be. You don't want to come to work and go through all of this and go through a mess.
Go ahead, Mr. Trump, please. Go ahead, okay. Here. We'll
go ahead. Give me the next one. This letter came to my attention, which is one of two that I have in my position. Again, this personnel is former firemen.
They're still in the
department, sorry. Citing poor leadership, total disregard for camaraderie, refused to work for someone that sends out emails such as chief ranks, etc., which we've already addressed. Honestly, consider creating a resignation.
Is this an email? Facebook email? Is that what this is?
It was a message. This was a message to the center. Go to your next one. This is part of the email, this is part of the Facebook.
That is the chief, correct?
That is from the chief of this fire department? Is that correct?
Where does it say that up here?
Was this posted on the fire department's website or Facebook? Was this on social media? Not
Brad Chief Phillips. I mean,
this was on Brad. It's personal.
Could you go back to that song?
Not fire department, but personal. This is Brad. Is that correct?
What's it say?
Personally, I don't find very offensive. I do find backstabbing, lying, cheating, and people over offensive but not swearing. Again, this was a personal.
What's it say on the top of that? That one email. What's it say?
Brad Phillips' personal Facebook page.
That's his personal one, not his departmental. Thank you.
You need a Brad Phillips page.
It identifies it says on there?
Yes.
Appreciate you doing that. I see nothing like further, we don't have stretches for 11 o'clock. Councilman, I have something to say to each one of you. You can yell, you can scream, you can kick me out if you like. But I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do in our next council. I will make a motion that we direct the city manager to dismiss Brad Phillips.
I'm quite sure you can do that.
I'm going to do it.
No, I said council can't force me to fire anybody.
I can make a motion.
You can make a motion.
Okay, I'm not trying to force you, Randy, but it will get out there if that's what needs to be done. I can't think from this council or any other council. But after agreement, you know, I've been upset since the start of the meeting. He has no, from what I see, no regard for the chain of command. He tells everybody else they have to follow. Okay? That's one of them. That's mine. But this, what I just agreed on, is enough. Okay? We need to get the department back on track. Second of that, we need, as a council, to sit down and see if we can get the problem back. We're not getting people because of overpay. I've heard that from several people. We can look at that and see what we can do. I'm done. Thank you, Mr. Cook.
We look at the major data, we have to look at the town and the bus as well, because they're the ones that have to pay their own. And I think last time it was overlooked by our former city manager from Elizabeth Township when we gave raises, that you guys did not have a say in that, correct? Elizabeth Township, was last time that we increased the last time we gave our fire EMS crews a pay raise, Elizabeth Township didn't have a say in that, correct?
That's correct.
Sure. So if we do it again this time, we would have to bring you in and get your opinion on that.
Okay, is that it for the presentation, Mr. Cook? Are you finished?
All right.
Anybody else like to speak? Mr. Zambach.
When I first spoke, I asked you out there to give us new information. You did. Thank you very much. We appreciate your input. A lot of food for thought that I didn't have before. And
no, you're fine.
Thank you.
That's what we're sure.
I believe in there. Does this right? Right. You guys do a great job for us. I'm very thankful that you are here, each and every one. Thank you.
Sure.
Oh, you can't say a thing.
Bill, this question's for you and maybe Ron or anybody else on the fire department. I keep hearing this constant theme about some of our people in the fire department working for another fire department. Is it the goal to pay-wise attract some of those people who only work for New Carlisle? Is that what you're talking about? Because I'm also hearing that you don't want people working full-time, right?
No. I think what we've got a problem with, if we have them working part-time, we're going to get away from paying them health benefits, etc.
Right.
Now, when these people are trained by the other departments and come over here and work, we don't really have to train them because they've already got a certification. So we're winning on one hand, but we're losing on the other.
Did we ask for proof of that certification from the other training agency?
I'm sure that every time that somebody comes on to the department, you've got it.
So, when we have somebody come on new to the department, I need to have, and I put together their files and everything on what training that they have, what certification their level. The things that we have to ask for is, or I have to give the training to you, is you have to pass your Greater Miami Valley protocols to be able to run in this 10-county Greater Miami Valley area. You have to pass those protocols. You have till July 31st of each year to pass those. If you do not pass those, then you're not going to run in this area. I personally run in three different areas, so I have three different protocols that I have to pass every year. There are state standards that people have to continue with their continuing ed. I can't tell you off the top of my head how much continuing ed each level has to have. There are certain things that the state requires, like blood-borne pathogens. There's a couple other ones, basic like hand hygiene and that type of thing, that we have to take as a department. If you do not take it, then you have to show me from your other department where you've taken that. With the protocols, I just went through all the protocols this morning. Springfield, wherever they're getting. But they have to show me each year proof that they've taken those. And then I can get into the database, and I was working today with Jesse from the Greater Miami Valley EMS Council on getting the database updated and everything, and getting people out of there that's no longer on our roster. That was very diligent. So there are things that we require that the state requires. Now, I have to go through every month. I go through and see whose certification is going to run out and expire, and then I check it to make sure that they've reapplied and everything, whether or not they're nationally registered. State of Ohio does not require national registry as an EMT to continue on. You just have to be State of Ohio certified. That certification comes up every 3 years. Every 3 years, I come to the people and make sure that they, you know, I send out reminders, or I go to them, talk to them personally and say, hey, you need to renew this year. Have you renewed? I need a copy of your card. I don't necessarily have to have a copy of the card because I can pull it up on the website. So I can get a copy of it. But there are things that are required that they have to do. Now, we provide a lot of in-house training because over the years, many departments have faced this, that training costs a lot. It's an average of $20 in a credit hour to get your certification. Now, if you're looking at getting, as a paramedic, I think I need over 40 credit hours in certain areas. Now, I pay for them out of my own pocket to go out and take these classes and everything to recertify. But if you look at it as a paramedic firefighter, I have to have 80 hours of continuing ed that I have to provide for on my own, unless I pay do a reimbursement with the city, which then I have to sign a contract saying I'm going to be working for them for such and such amount of time. Now, 80 hours, think about that. That's 2 weeks, unpaid, that you have to now pay to get your certification back. So we have made New Carlisle a site, that was done before I got here, as an educational site. We have numerous trainers that come in. We offer more continuing ed now than we have ever offered at New Carlisle. And I went back through records back to 1990. So 25 years, we offer more now. We're doing weekly fire trainings. We're doing a Saturday fire training. And we're doing it all with in-house instructors. We're doing EMS trainings every other week and whenever there's an extra day that we can pick up. Now, anybody that wants to come in and teach a class, we've got numerous instructors, and they can teach under that instructor. They just have to turn in their timelines and outlines and what they want to teach about and everything. And I've put out numerous messages on people that want to, you know, want to teach classes. Steve Trustee has stepped up on several occasions. Jerry Meadow, our new intermediate, has stepped up and said, hey, I can teach this class. I'm going to teach this. So we're now making available to them, if they come to all the trainings, they will be able to recertify without having to pay to go get their certification or get these continuing ed hours. So we quadrupled it. And we opened it up to other surrounding departments. Anybody can come in.
We have a comment here. Go ahead.
Larry Trustee, Member MT Department. I just recertified both my cards and all my training was through here. And I missed a single hour, and I was approved from the state on my EMT card and my firefighter card.
We have two of them.
Right here.
Doug Pearson, Captain. You guys asked me, I think it was a couple weeks ago, how do you go about to get volunteers in the city? Correct? Okay, I heard he put it in the paper.
Yeah, it's been in the newspaper, it's been on social media. this is really kind of funny. Every Monday I go down and hang a flyer at Lee's Chicken. Every Monday morning, every Monday afternoon, that flyer for volunteers has been taken down.
But
so
you guys are talking about part-time people, which is great. You've got to work on volunteers in the city. Like, maybe put a sign out in front of the firehouse. I mean, volunteers are important too.
We have signs on order for each of the entrances into New Carlisle.
Well, how do we combat the national trend where volunteers are going bye-bye? How do you combat, I'm asking you, how do you combat that? We're not unique in that issue. We're having a hard time getting volunteers. That's, from what I've read, what I've been told, that's a trend going on nationwide, especially in smaller departments.
And
but you got to announce it. I mean, you got to put it out there.
I mean, I know they are now. The people who are having the similar issues are doing their best to get volunteers in.
I understand. They're doing it now. Okay. I brought it up a couple weeks ago. But that's great. It's doing, being done now. But I'm saying, you got to look at volunteer side too. I mean, they're just as, I'm not bothered, just as important as anybody else.
Sure.
I mean, you know, you got to have them. They've got to be on these runs.
We just have to do what we can to get people in.
Yeah, we do.
It's very difficult. We got to do everything we can.
Could you guys start going to the high school and doing like your quarterly, doing something in the auditorium about it, like presentations or something?
Can we hang on one moment? Yeah.
You've been talking a lot. We appreciate it.
You told me.
Another thing. Okay, this is back to the investigation. Okay, you said everything come out fine on that, correct?
That's what we were told.
That was the findings of the investigation. Yes. That's what we were
okay.
told.
And I brought up the fact of the firefighter drinking that was on him. Now, is that fine?
No.
That's what I mean, Eric.
So he was drinking, like literally drinking.
He wasn't drinking at all, Daniel. He was drinking.
Let me ask you this, though. I don't want to put you on the spot. It's a question. I ask tough questions. I know this. Were you at that same wedding?
Yes, I was. Was I at the front? Yes, I was. Was I the one who told him not to not get off that engine? Yes, I was.
So who allowed him on the engine to begin with?
He allowed him what?
Who allowed him to get on the engine to begin with?
Well, our battalion done left. Okay. I got off midnight. Our battalion done left.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He should know not to get on that engine.
That's so an you're the chief, though, so you could not tell him not to get on that engine.
I was not at the fire.
I think he was the officer at the station. He made the decision himself to get on the engine. I think
right.
That's what I was.
Not him.
Not me. The gentleman.
I went from my house to the scene.
Got
it. Right. And they're saying that was okay. Is that what they're saying on the investigation?
Who is that?
I'm the investigator.
I don't think that investigation, this group approved that the gentleman was even intoxicated or not. This is the first time that I've heard that this person was actually drinking.
Are we allowed to discuss a personnel issue in open forum like this?
No.
But it's definitely my
turn. Somebody else is still over there. I'm Corey Wise. I'm a former fireman with the city. I'm also an EMT basic. If we can for a minute, let's think about something that's intangible. Nothing that maybe was specifically money spent or something done. Let's think about leadership and retention of personnel and maybe a little bit about the time value of money if I can fit that on in 5 minutes. Time value of money, right? We pay a little bit lower than other departments for basics and paramedics. People do become more available as money is increased, right? I would happily drop a contract with Wise Landscaping and replace it with somebody that I can make 10% more gross profit on every day of the week. Without increasing my overhead costs, I can make more money. Why wouldn't I do that? Now, I don't think it's all about money. Let's think about leadership. What's leadership to you, sir? Not to be on spot.
No, it's pretty much over there.
But you specifically, what does a good leader look like to you?
I mean, someone that can talk to the people, that can, you know, they feel free to come in and talk to them, and they, you know, they all run as a, you know, well-oiled machine.
Okay. Mr. McIntyre, what's a good leader look like to you?
A leader is somebody who leads, not just gives orders, but out there at the very front with the people doing it. They can get the job done by being there and compelling other people to do it because they put themselves on the line first and foremost. That's me.
Okay, I would agree. Will we all agree that everybody knows a toxic leader? Has everybody here met a toxic leader?
Yeah.
That's somebody that can, a toxic leader can take those 30 pyramids and turn it into 19. And we're talking 2,880-ish hours in a month. Maybe we do need to increase our staffing. Maybe money isn't the whole thing, right? Yeah, continuing education is great, but I could probably recertify for like the next 5 years with the training I get at Bethel Clark. It's nothing special. It's just something that fire departments offer. So I think that's kind of neither here nor there. We need to improve the morale of the department. Money helps.
leadership is better. Good leaders are invaluable. Bad leaders will sink your ship fast. That's all I really have to say. Right? Money is great. Leadership is better. And I think that everybody can probably agree. Maybe we can't look at those hard, fast facts, but let's look at those intangible things that would allow us to paint a picture of, is this person a good leader?
Thank you, sir. With your comments, sir, and I don't want to dig into this, but I'm going to bring it up. Okay, you're saying that bad leadership possibly costs some of the numbers of the firehouse. But I'm going to say, and I'm not saying you're wrong, I'm not trying to debunk what you're saying, but I'm also saying I'd heard numerous people say before chief was hired that if a certain chief wasn't hired, people would start quitting. Now, I'm not saying that's the case, but that always sticks in the back of my mind. So I'm thinking instantly, if I don't know what's going to happen with Chief Phillips in the future, no one does. If Chief's replaced with someone else, are we going to have the same issue because it's not who somebody wants?
I think that invariably there are going to be personnel who are displeased with the gentleman or the lady that is appointed fire chief. I also think that after about 6 months, most people get over that BS.
Okay.
Because that's really what it is. Yeah, right. Maybe I don't like Dan or him, and I don't want to be my chief.
Right.
But at the end of the day, he's my chief, and he treats me good. I know that he's going to take care of me, back me up, and not just throw me under the bus and let all the wheels hit me.
Right.
I can get over that. I don't like Dan. The issue isn't who do we like and who do we dislike. It's who has had the opportunity and has failed to provide solid leadership in a purely leadership sense. training is great. People that organize training are awesome. Because good training events can build camaraderie, they can increase morale. But if you're doing all these things that build up camaraderie, increase morale, okay, good training, not have to worry about your CEUs. What's the purpose of building that arc if you're going to take the biggest steel chainsaw you can find and cut it right down a beam?
Mm-hmm. Good answer. Thank you. Anybody else? Let's go here. Brad,
I thought you were supposed to have the people there that did the investigation or whatever they called it.
Do you have the money to have them here? We don't.
That's
not how this works. Investigators usually go back to a room and say, all right, what do you guys not like about what I did? That's just not how it works.
No, not that. It's like, didn't you understand what we needed? Because obviously they didn't.
I think they did their mission and they did what they're supposed to do. Nancy, let me ask you this. If it had come out to the opposite, do you think you'd be sitting here right now?
Yeah.
Absolutely not.
What?
Absolutely not. They looked at the operational aspect of what Brad was doing. And the information that was given to them.
They said what he was doing.
That was
okay.
Fine.
And
now it's being switched to leadership. Now we've got to look at it from a leadership perspective, not an operational perspective.
You know, I said, Mr. Cook just pointed out all the things he should have been doing, so why weren't they?
And Captain Bowman just pretty much debunked everything that Mr. Cook said. And Captain Bowman just shot a hole in everything that, no offense to Mr. Cook, but Captain Bowman pretty much addressed every one of those bullet points in that yellow thing about recruitment.
Because I did something.
Thank you. We have somebody turn it back. Go ahead. Would you stand up, please, identify yourself?
My name is Laura McDowell, the 606 Walsh. I was just wondering, in talking with this gentleman here, why does our fire department not do pass the boot anymore? That was something we did every single year. And no matter what, I would put something in there. We haven't done that in years. That's something that the fire department can do to get money back in their pockets, too.
And that's traditional about those fire departments.
It's been, at least 4 years.
Sure.
Or longer.
So who was the last chief to do that?
I'm not sure.
What's that?
Impact F, what we did it for Impact F.
Yeah.
We raised like $5,000 to $6,000 for the year.
Hey, thank you. Impact F for
thank you. Appreciate it. Anyone else I have over here? Yes, possibly. I got a question. We got 42 people on the roster. 19 respond or paid or showing up. What's the other 43 doing?
That's a good question. That's a $1 million question.
We're asking.
They're evidently working for other departments when...
But I understand that. But priority are the citizens of this community.
Priority one.
They pay for the apparatus for the SCBA, the turnout here, the acceptance. We should be first priority. I know your contract is to Elizabeth Township. I don't know what your contract reads on that, I don't have any idea. But as a taxpayer, I feel that my first responsibility to that department is to me, or to the citizens of the community.
And that's why we're here, is trying to fight this off. Exactly right.
Mr. Cobb, that 19 that I mentioned, that was just firefighter paramedics. That's not including firefighter EMT basics or advanced, or just fire only. We have 16 firefighter EMTs as well as the 19 firefighter paramedics, and then we have seven fire only personnel. Now, I do believe, Jen, you can probably answer this better than I can. There are, of those 42, that's how I came up with 42, is a breakdown of the firefighter paramedics and firefighter EMT basics and the fire only personnel. It's not just 19 personnel that are responding. However, of those 19 firefighter paramedics, 10 of them work full-time at other departments. And so you subtract, you know, a lot of those are firefighter paramedics or firefighter EMT basics that come in and work on a part-time program only. However, as far as pay per call or the actual volunteers who live in the city, if I had to take a wild guess, it's probably around 4 to 7 personnel that are actually able to respond for a fire.
I understand that, but what I'm trying to say here, if the duty crew goes out on the medic, they make a medic call. We've now got a call from mutual aid. And I listen to this all the time now.
Correct.
Okay. A lot of times you have trouble getting the medic out of Bethel. You have trouble getting the medic out of Bethel Mining.
Correct.
Pike Township, forget it, they're in the hole. Okay, you've got to go to the end, Springfield Township, etc. There's no reason, as a taxpayer of this community, that I should have to wait for a second medic to get out there. If my house is burning, I've got to wait for somebody to get there and put the fire out. If that happens, I'm going to be upset.
And you're absolutely correct.
If I'm laying in my driveway with a heart attack dead, somebody's going to pay. Because you can't get a second medic out there.
Correct. Currently right now it's staffing,
and I don't know what, you know, this young lady here, you know, yes, she may be putting a lot of hours in, and I feel sorry for you.
Don't feel sorry for me,
Well, I mean, it takes you from your family life. But my complaint is, like I say, you tell me 42 people on the roster, and we can't get shifts scheduled. Something wrong.
Thank you, Mr. Cobb. We appreciate it.
Where goes something else? Sorry. Can you go back through here and tell me? I didn't take good enough notes, apparently. So if it's a P next to their name, what does that mean?
Paramedic. That means they're a paramedic. There's a B, they're an EMT basic.
One. Okay. Makes sense. Okay.
I believe it's.
What's A?
An A would be an advanced or what used to be called a. EMT intermediate.
Okay.
Which basically they're between an EMT basic and a paramedic position. There are certain things that they cannot do that a paramedic can do. And they when you're looking at it from a state standpoint, in order to be considered an ALS ambulance unit, you have to have a paramedic on board.
Okay, and what's T stand for?
T is a trainee.
That would make sense, and then at this point.
If it's blank, they are a fire-only person.
Thank you.
Yes.
Good, that was our stand for you.
Go ahead.
I had a question, but Mr. Pearson, to ask you a question. A couple weeks ago, you came to the meeting, and you were the one that was talking about some of the issues that happened in the fire department. Now, the issue of leadership, particularly toxic leadership, has come up several times tonight. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit on any leadership issues you may see. If you're feel comfortable doing that.
Well, on leadership, like I said, you gotta have somebody there to lead you in the first place.
And that is not happening?
And
past? You do not believe that is happening.
Well, not the way it's supposed to be. I mean, you know, you... But you gotta go, it's like you gotta respect, you gotta give respect, okay? And that's like, we had a meeting, Brandon come in, he made us all sign a piece of paper that we could not talk about.
Which a lot of people didn't obey that order now, did they?
Huh?
A lot of people did not.
I don't know. I don't know. Huh? But does that, yeah, but that's not an order. I mean, you can't make people not talk.
If I go in there and say, do not speak about an internal investigation that is ongoing, and you do that, I have every right to do that.
But he still got after the investigation is done.
I think some people spoke during the investigation before.
Yeah.
Just because, believe me, please, people email me stuff, people tell me stuff, and just because you think they're your film board, they may not be. So, I know a lot more than what you guys think, I'll tell you that.
Well, I'm not saying it.
Sure.
Okay.
But this is different, but.
Sure.
I'd like to do another boot thing.
Another what?
Another collect money for the boot.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. I'm down, absolutely. So.
Okay, well, we'll get together.
Yeah. When you guys get hired, did you say you were only going to work certain times? I got hired today and they told me for half a day I was going to work these hours. If I didn't show up, you guys, I was terminated. So I'm not following why everybody can pick and choose.
There's never been a rule so to speak, on that. Basically, the entire schedule is based on what we call preferences or availability of the people.
Yeah,
and
obviously.
Like Mr. Rem has said that, you know, we've got a lot of people that work other jobs, not just other full-time fire jobs.
I understand what you're saying. It's just it seems strange to me, and I'm not making it.
But it's a part-time job, and if people aren't available to work a part-time job, they're not available. I mean, if anybody's full-time job is going to be their priority, period.
Then they shouldn't pick a
part-time
job.
I totally agree with you. If you don't have the time to dedicate, then they shouldn't be there. I agree.
Steve Schaefer, firefighter paramedic. Chairman of the current recruitment committee. To a little bit better clarify, just with the way that part-time fire departments work, and this is not a call-out thing. Metro Township, Bethlehem Township, Pike, Springfield Township, everybody puts in their availability, and then it's people are plugged into the hours that need filled.
So
if
she's calling for people, nobody's showing up, and obviously it's not working.
Right, and yeah, absolutely, and that has absolutely nothing, well, not nothing, but that was happening before even the current fire chief is, yeah, and it also, like I said, that alone, that isn't just a new Carlisle thing either. I can tell you right now, I started my career in Maverick Township, Enum. At that time, we had a max of 70 members, whether that be support members, which were the retirees that would come in and bring coffee, stuff like that, on fires, to firefighter only, EMT only, paramedic, you know, the whole shebang. All but one of those individuals, and he lived right at the border. All of those individuals lived in Metro Township. I made a lot, and I'm talking a lot of money, between the hours of 1 a.m. and 5 a.m. on calls that people didn't want to go on. And I didn't have to transport but maybe a handful of them because I was the only one that showed up. Because nobody wants to go in Grandma Falls at 3 o'clock in the morning, wants to go to the hospital. They don't want to do it. And you can't put the proverbial gun to their head and say, hey, go on that call. They're the volunteer paper call. And that's with a department with 69 members that live in a responding zone. that responds all the time, that an hour later, a structure fire comes out, it's blown out of four windows. Well, they weren't available 20 minutes ago, but they're available now, because we just had six trucks pull out of the station. You see it happen 1,000 times. Chief Cotterman can even attest to that, that we'll send a medic, Bethel Township will send a medic out there. They get a good car accident, all of a sudden they have availability. So getting people in here is not going to solve the problem. You're always going to have the I'm not available, and which is the same as it is on the part-time, same as it is on paper.
That's
been going on for years.
Hey, we have a gentleman back there. Go ahead.
Dustin Mason, firefighter here in Nashville, Carlisle. I was one of the 10 that Dan spoke of that had a full-time job.
Could you speak up just a little bit?
I was one of the 10 that Dan spoke of that had a full-time job. I enjoy my job here in Carlisle. I enjoy my full-time job, obviously, as well. I think a lot of the things that people don't realize is that nobody becomes a firefighter because they expect to get rich. Like, we work a lot of hours so that when we make, we're that medium to the road salary, we're working 56 to 75 hours a week, and we don't get to go home to our families at night and see our kids. So you do, especially if you do have a full-time job, such as a few of us do, but you have to prioritize what's important in your life. So, like, obviously, you have to have your family, you have to raise your family, but to do that, you need money to do that. So where are you going to get that money from? Are you going to go and to your part-time job, prioritize that over your full-time job? Obviously, a lot of people aren't going to do that. So I think that's where a lot of the personnel issues come into. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have that part-time personnel that works full-time elsewhere. I think there's you can make a department very successful with a collage of different employees, so to speak. But everybody's different, I guess. I don't know. I kind of just wanted to defend that aspect of it. For me, it's not. I enjoy working here. I'm a firefighter paramedic because I love the job. If I could live at the firehouse, I would do it. And sometimes I feel like I do, but at the same time, I have a wife at home. I know, but I have a wife at home that I hear about all the time when I come home. So, you know, my marriage is priority over any job, even my full-time job. And she said you weren't going to go into work to your full-time job, but I'm going to leave you. I'm going to stay at home. So,
thank you for your service. We really appreciate it. Just to let everybody know, we're definitely going to end this at 8:30. So if somebody else would like to speak, please, Bill, go ahead.
Bill, anything you've been with your crowd. I guess I have a couple of questions. First of all, I want to thank all the fire department for what you do. Most of you, some of you know me, some of you don't. I am a retired firefighter. Takes a lot of guts and other things to run into a burning fire. Whether you have your proper equipment or not, hopefully you will have turnout gear on. I've been in many fires without an air pack to save somebody. I know it's stupid, I put my own life at risk more than one occasion, but that's part of the job if it's them dying or you grabbing an air pack. I think it was a lieutenant that was drinking at a wedding and then responded on a fire truck. Is that what I heard earlier from some of them? Excuse me?
Yeah, we're at three different times.
Okay. When I was a firefighter, if you showed up at the station and even touched a piece of equipment and had alcohol in your breath, you was no longer a member of that department. There wasn't no suspension, you was gone. That came from our chief. Our chief ruled with an iron fist. Everybody hated him, but everybody would follow him any place he went. That goes back to leadership. The chiefs I had, both of them, they're both gone now, they're both deceased. Everybody hated them two men, but they would have followed him to anywhere because of their leadership ability. And I thought I forgot the same thing I was going to say.
Thank you, we appreciate it. Just 1 minute. You've already spoken. The gentleman next to me has not spoken yet. Go ahead.
My name is Curtis Corn. I'm a firefighter with the department.
I'm also a city, citizen of the city. I also live at 1022 Edgeburg, which is, this stuff is kind of hard to talk about because I was the one who had the house fire. I was the one who had the house fire that the end, the Quint showed up with one person. So your guys' questions about people not staffing and stuff, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm a citizen. It sucks. 9 months later, I'm still reliving it. 9 months later. And it sucks. I'd like to see something done. That doesn't happen to any of you guys. Because I am both sides. Hopefully from the help of people, I should be in my house at the end of the month. But for 9 months, my wife, my two sons, have been out of my house. That worked so hard. And sweat, and time away from my family to get and to make it what it was. But I just want to let you, the citizens of Selma, know there's two sides in the fire department that has felt the effects. I'm going to tell you it sucks. I figured I'd let some of you citizens know that too. That it has happened. And, you know, you at least got one person here to send those sides. That's all I got to say.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Anybody else? Mr. Moore, we haven't heard from you.
Just got one thing. I believe that today enacted a battalion pay position. Now, Brad didn't talk to myself. Did he talk to you, Chief Ritter? Okay. My understanding, I don't know the whole how it's working, but my understanding through here hearsay is that we're paying the time position now 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, well over 100,000. If we can pay for seven people to work for that 100,000, I think that might be better spent to give raises to the people and maybe bring in more staffing in, spread the money out instead of just seven people to enhance the department, bring more people in possibly.
So instead of adding a person, you want to give people more money and just get like hoping, wish on a prayer that that's going to call people in. I would rather have more people at the same amount of money that they're completely comfortable with making. I'm completely comfortable making my $1.69.
Hey, thank you for tonight. Anybody else? We've had both of the street. Anybody that hasn't spoken would like to speak.
I kind of direct order for the board, but then it's a church.
Okay.
Or you were kind of the one that kind of headed this, and I don't mean in a nice way, headed this up. You were the one that kind of stepped up for the podium the first time.
I was the first one to speak.
Right, and that's what I'm asking. Are you, you know, there's no outcome yet, but are you happy with what you're seeing
tonight? I see.
And I'm not saying about what's going to happen. I'm just saying
what I see is councilmen and the city manager are listening and asking, I think, appropriate questions. And I see concern. I see a different what I saw the first time.
That's what I hope that all of you guys see. We're here to listen to what you guys all have to say. He's up all behind you a couple meetings later. You guys really shed, you know, some light to some people. So
that's why we called this meeting, because we wanted to hear what everybody had to say. That was the purpose of it. We had an investigation. It was an investigation. You didn't respond. A lot of people didn't respond to them. We didn't hear those sides of what was going on. That's why we're having this meeting tonight. All seven members of council said, yes, we need to do this. We did it. We're here. We heard that tonight. So thank you all for being here. We do appreciate it. We appreciate everybody showing up.
Can
city manager wanted to say something.
I have two quick questions about when we had someone that spoke yet, so.
Can I ask how we're saving the $13,000 by limiting the assistant use costs?
We didn't hear the question.
Can I ask how we're saving $13,000 by eliminating the assistant use costs?
Yes, that would do with obviously numbers and reduction of
okay,
hours.
Okay, can you tell me how much
again, I finished my comment, I don't have the information in front of me, so I'm not going to comment on it, because I don't want to speculate or guess as to how that number
is. Captain Bowman, can you tell me how much the battalion officers are supposed to be paid for the 24-hour shifts that they're running?
I don't know what fund it's coming out of, and that was one thing that I know Chief Phillips was working with Colleen on that, trying to figure out what fund that they were going to pull that out of. This is the first month today, the first day I'm running battalion today. This is the first day.
How much are you making an hour?
I make $14.21 an hour.
Okay.
I believe that's
Steve
what
Schaefer
is
on one of the battalion spots. How much would he make an hour?
He's going to make his hourly rate, whatever. What did you say that was?
Toss.
Okay. And EMT basic, what do they make an hour? I'm sorry, I'm here.
Please, can we not? We're getting into heated discussions.
My question is that we have seven spots that are running 24-hour shifts at these variable pays. How is that saving us $13,000?
And we don't know the answer to that. The city manager just said he doesn't know the answer to that.
So you're going
to
remove these spots and let them work, go ahead and do this, not knowing
if
how much it's going to cost?
If it's saving $13,000, we're going to do what saves $13,000.
But you don't know how much it's going to cost?
And I just said I don't have the information in front of me, so I'm not going to comment on it, so I don't want people to speculate.
But you're letting them go ahead and do it.
My foot saver is over $100,000.
Yeah, because that was a recommendation from two guys who are very qualified to make those recommendations, ma'am. You're gonna try to discredit our investigator recommended.
I understand, but we're trying to save recruitment, retention, bring all these people in. I think it would be more beneficial to put more manpower on, correct?
Can I be frank with you? If we're drawing 10 more people into that department,
okay.
People still need to pick up shifts.
Absolutely.
That's the problem.
But when you have certain people just constantly making money,
mm-hmm.
And no, I mean,
well, this is
I'll be frank. I'm an assistant chief at the department down the street.
Mm-hmm.
I made $28,000 last year. My chief pay is $13,000. I don't get blue cards. I don't get comp time. I work for 9 weeks, 12-hour shifts for free. If I come with my family, all of that crap. That's what you have to do when you're an officer. Not go on all these excursions and leave your city uncovered. Plain and simple.
How do we go on excursions?
We went to Indianapolis and left the city with this young man that was a brand new EMT firefighter by himself.
So you didn't have a partner, Jeff?
Yeah.
That's right. No.
Cooper wasn't there. Okay, then we need to look at payroll because we paid somebody to be there.
Well, I think we did too. That was a lot of area confidence.
That's my question.
So can we go back to the recommendation again?
Yeah.
By himself?
Yep.
Sir, you're by yourself.
So that means someone put in pay that wasn't there. We even have the email that went out before they all left. We don't have shifts covered.
Ma'am.
We don't have shifts covered.
We're not getting aggressive, but we're not saying things.
You're right.
That is
but
not
at the same time, you
that's
guys are letting this city do this without knowing how much it's going to cost you. How is that responsible?
Okay, first off.
How is that responsible?
Hey, hold on, that's enough. It's enough to hold.
Send out an email.
Meeting's closed. It's after 8:30. That's it for tonight. Thank you. We're not getting in to hollering at each other. That's the last thing this community.